Hello and welcome to a hot and humid afternoon in Kigali. I'm battling to stay cool at the moment. But what I thought I would do today is to kick off a series that I've kind of been thinking about for a while now, in which we look at news stories from within Rwanda that don't tend to get outside the country and don't tend to be known about further afield. Because I know at the moment there are loads of news stories about Rwanda internationally in the mainstream media. But, you know, there are also a lot of interesting local news articles that crop up from time to time. And I just thought it would be interesting to dive into a few of them, either because they're events that have happened that are kind of interesting, or because they raise topics that are interesting to talk about, maybe in a development context, and things to discuss about potentially the future of the country. So that's what I thought I'd do, is each episode I'd maybe pick two or three local news stories to take a little bit of a look at, and let's dive in. So the first story that I want to jump into today is about Pastor Ezra Mpyisi, who unfortunately passed away in January, just short of his 102nd birthday. Now, it's not so much Pastor Mpyisi himself that I'm so interested in, but about what he represents in terms of religion in the country, because he is often spoken about as being possibly the oldest Christian priest from Rwanda. So just to give a bit of context, Christianity first arrived in Rwanda around 1900, so the turn of that century, and it was brought here by a group of Catholic missionaries called, and I kid you not, the White Fathers. Now, if you were going to pick a more inappropriate name than that, I can't think of one. I guess we can all just be a bit grateful that they didn't come from Spain and they weren't dressed as capirote, because that would have been a really bad look. So they arrived and they were pretty well established by about 1906. And then Pastor Mpyisi was born in 1922. So his life really does span the length of Christianity in the country. On a slight diversion here, I was watching the Oscar highlights the other day, and I can't remember who it was, but one of the winners held up his Oscar and mentioned that movies had only been around for about 100 years. I thought, oh, really? So I went and looked that up, and it's true. It's the first ever public showing of a film, of a movie, was in Paris in 1895. So that's just short of 130 years. Next year will be 130 years since movies were invented. And so just thinking that through, Christianity has existed in Rwanda for less time than movies have existed. It really just made me stop and go, huh? Because, you know, when you think about Rwanda and you think about many countries in Africa, you think about very conservative Christianity, which we kind of associate with the history of Christianity. So, you know, I wouldn't go as far as saying it's as draconian as a Spanish Inquisition, more akin to sort of, I guess, the American Bible Belt sort of Christianity than, say, the Vicar of Dibley. Yeah, you know what I'm saying there. So, I mean, most countries in the old world have had Christianity for a really long time. So the UK, about 1,500 years. I worked in Armenia for a brief minute. And one fact that I remember about Armenia is that it was the first country in the entire world to become Christian in 301 AD. So, I mean, about 1,700 years. So a generation is generally considered to be between about 20 to 30 years. So we'll take 25 as the middling ground there. But if we look right back to the dawn of Christianity, I guess from Armenia through to most of Europe, you're looking at around 75 to 80 generations of people. So that's your great, 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 great 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 grandfather or grandmother, whereas when we're looking at Christianity in Rwanda, we're talking about four, maybe five generations. And I just find that kind of fascinating and a little difficult to get my head around. Today, what we're finding is that religion, or at least conservative religion, Christianity, Islam, is starting to disappear. And there's an incredible video, I'll link to it below, but it sort of goes through the countries of the world that are now becoming majority atheist, or, you know, majority non-religious or non-affiliated. And it's happening at an incredible, incredible rate. And it's just really, really interesting to see that after about 1,500 years, most countries are over it now, but that you still find very, very focused, ardent Christian beliefs in countries where it's only existed for a very, very short amount of time. And I don't know, I just find it very, very interesting. And I'm curious to see what that means for the future. Because whilst I was going through some of this research, there seems to be a trend that greater economic development brings with it an inevitable decline in religion. So there's a really interesting TED talk by a guy called David Vos, which I'll link to below, which is very much so worth watching if you're interested in this topic. And there's also a book called Beyond Doubt, The Secularization of Society, by a guy called Ryan Cragan. And what he discovered in this book is that the decline of religion tends to occur when two criteria are met. And these two criteria are the freedom to choose religion or to be non-religious, and the modernization of a country. Now, what's really interesting is that both of these criteria are met in Rwanda. Is first of all, Rwanda is technically, it's a secular state. So, you know, you have total freedom of religion. So the majority are Christian, then you have a significant Islamic populace in Rwanda. There's a Hindu temple in Rwanda. You have the freedom to choose and you can be non-religious. Often I find people find it harder to understand that somebody would not believe in anything. You know, it's kind of like, it doesn't matter what you believe in so long as you believe in something. But I have met and spoken with Rwandan atheists as well. And there's no persecution for being non-religious. There might be kind of a social priorism going on there, but there's no sort of fear of legal punishment or, you know, violence against you because of your religion. And Rwanda is modernizing, and not just the infrastructure that exists, like the roads have appeared, buildings, high rises, all of that's happening. Electricity and water is getting more reliable. But also there are big plans for the future. So there's a sort of a smart cities plan, which looks to create or to integrate technology into the city in the future. So to digitize services and, you know, to really grow the country as an example of how technology can improve people's lives. So it's not just that, you know, improvements have happened, there are huge plans to continue that trend. So when we look at Rwanda, both of those criteria are met. And for me, that's just something that I think is going to be really, really interesting to see going forward, is if that push towards modernization combined with the freedom to choose your religion or not be religious will speed up the process of the decline of religion. Because like I said, it took like 1,500 years in most countries in Europe for that to begin. So it will be interesting to see if with this spurt of modernization in Africa, whether or not religion drops off faster or as fast as it was adopted, or whether or not it's going to become sort of a bastion, like a last stronghold of religious belief. I don't know. And if there is going to be a decline in religion, I don't think we're going to see it in the next couple of months, but check in maybe a couple of decades, and I think we'll have some idea of which direction it's likely to go in. Okay, so second news story today is that the population of Rwanda has exceeded 13 million. Now, I'm a little bit confused by this story because when I looked up the population of Rwanda on Google, it seemed to suggest that that had been surpassed in 2021, whereas this news article came out in February of 2023, so February last year. So at the moment, the population is, I think, it's something around 13.5 million. So I'm not sure why the delay between the statistic being reached, I can't say that, the statistic being reached and the publishing of this news article. If you know, let me know below. But Rwanda consistently ranks as one of the most highly densely populated countries in the world. And I just wanted to try and put that into perspective a little bit. So one way of talking about the size of a country is to talk about its total size in kilometers or miles square. I think it's probably more useful to look at the total land mass, just because, you know, there aren't that many people living underneath the water in a country. Don't tend to survive very long doing that. So I think it's probably better to look at the total land mass. So if we're going to make comparisons to help us to visualize, then when we talk about the size of Rwanda, its closest comparative country in size is probably North Macedonia near Greece. They are quite similar in size. If you're from America, it might help to visualize Rwanda as sort of about the size of the state of Maryland. And if you're from the UK, thinking about it as being just a little bit bigger than Wales is probably about accurate. But what's really, really interesting then to look at is the comparative population. So, you know, North Macedonia, I think, is about 2 million people. Wales is about 3 million people. So when you're talking in those terms, to consider that Rwanda is about the same landmass, but it has more than 13 million people in it, that is a huge population. Now, the reason that this news article kind of caught my imagination is I am really interested in population statistics. Quite a while ago, there was this incredible, incredible guy called Hans Rosling. And unfortunately, he's now the late great Hans Rosling. He did pass on a couple of years ago, but he was a statistician for the UN and he was really into population statistics and his enthusiasm kind of drew me in. He did this brilliant documentary, I'll link to it below. It's called Don't Panic, The Truth About Population Statistics, because at the time, everybody was panicking because the world population appeared to be growing exponentially, like no end in sight, and the world was going to be completely overpopulated, and what were we going to do? So he made this documentary to kind of help calm people down, hence the title Don't Panic, because what the UN had realized for a long time is that the population is growing not because people are having more children, but because people are living longer. So due to modern medicine, due to awareness about nutrition, due to vaccines, people are just living a lot longer. And that kind of covers up the fact that beneath that, the actual rate of births is dropping significantly. We're already starting to see, if you look at populations like Japan, Portugal, Italy, it's nosediving much faster, I think, than a lot of people thought it would. Even in the UK at the moment, I think we're actually below replacement population, which means that couples are not having children fast enough or enough children to replace the population. So yes, the population of the world is going to continue to grow, but then when the older generation eventually moves on, there's going to be a sudden drop in population. They reckon it's going to happen round about 2080, so in about another 60 years. It might happen a bit sooner than that. We don't really know, but it does look like there's going to be a serious drop in population. And if you're interested in this, definitely go and have a watch of that documentary. It's fascinating. But something that is also interesting is that there's only one continent in the world that apparently is not under reproducing. So it is actually going to continue to grow and possibly triple in population, and that is Africa. because people are still having more children per couple. And so I just find that very, very interesting, because Rwanda is already one of the most densely populated countries in the entire world. And within the entire world, it's one of the countries that is set to continue to keep growing in population, whereas the rest of the world, not so much. And I find that fascinating. I was watching an interesting YouTuber the other day who was going around a town in sort of America that was now a ghost town because, you know, people had moved away, there wasn't a population reproducing there, you know, all the shops were like dead on the high street, there was nothing going on there, and basically they were just waiting for that town to kind of dwindle, peter out and disappear. And I was just sitting there trying to reconcile that in my head with the sort of the very rabid American view that there's no space here for immigrants. There's no way that we could possibly take in any immigrants. You've got entire towns that are dying, you know, get a baker in there, get a butcher in there, get, you know, get people in there with skills and bring the town back to life. And I think that when I look at the UK as well, is we're pursuing this very, very rabid xenophobic kind of approach of, oh no, get everybody out, you know, we don't want any immigrants in here. Well, I think you're either going to have to change that policy or disappear at some point, because, you know, population's going to be a problem. I don't know. I just find population very, very interesting. And I think it is going to completely change our world, completely. Just in terms of, you can't have a welfare state if there are more people claiming than paying in, which we're already noticing a problem with. I do think that population drop is going to be one of the defining points in our future as a species, because it's going to completely change everything that we know, down to economic policy, through to healthcare, through to housing, through to everything. It's going to completely rewrite it, and I find it fascinating. So the third story is actually really closely linked to the one we've just talked about. It's a very brief little addendum to it, is that the Population Housing Census 2022 pointed out that life expectancy in Rwanda is going up, and it's going up quite significantly. They reckon from about 51.2 years average to 69.6, and people in Rwanda are living on average 9 years longer than other countries in East Africa, which again, kind of going to compound the population issue there, but it's also, you know, that's great news. And they're putting it down to better healthcare provision and also greater awareness of well-being. So there's loads of initiatives in Rwanda that I think people outside the country maybe don't know about, but we have regular car-free days where they close down all of the roads in the city and people go out jogging and exercising. They've just built a running track, a walking track around the outside of the golf course at the end of my road. You often see people out exercising. You know, there's a real drive for health and well-being, eating better, exercising more. And it's really, really paying off, and people are noticing that. So that's kind of cool. And oh, the last bit of this story was about alcohol consumption. So there has been an increase in alcohol consumption in Rwanda. But what was quite funny is it doesn't rival Uganda. And I didn't know this until I read this article. But apparently, Uganda has the unhappy title of consuming the most alcohol of all African countries. So yeah, there's a bit of a drinking problem in Uganda at the moment. But yeah, I just thought that was a really interesting story, and I think it was very closely linked to population. So anyway, let me know if you've enjoyed this kind of format, if you reckon it's something I should keep doing, keep looking at different news stories, and let me know your thoughts on any of the stories below. So see you next time.